On behalf of the family, let me say thank you for gathering here. Know that your presence here means a great deal to them. I'd ask you to pray for them now and even in the days to come as they work through this process. But right now, let's take a few moments and let's pray together. We're going to do several things during our service today. We're going to hear some songs from the family, or some songs that the family has chosen. We're going to hear from some friends and spend some time in God's Word this morning. But let's pray now as we start our time together. Father, this morning we come . We want to echo the words of David in the Psalms, reaffirming our hope and our confidence that you are our shepherd, and we shall not want. Father, that you and you alone have the ability and the power to make us lie down in green pastures, a place where we can be refreshed and renewed. God, you and you alone lead us beside still waters, so we can drink and be restored. God, you and you alone restore our souls. Father, you lead us in paths of righteousness for your name and for your glory. And even in the moments like now, when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, God, we will fear no evil. For you are with us, your rod and your staff, they comfort us. And even in the presence of our greatest enemy, death, you go so far as to prepare a table before us, to bless us, to anoint our head with oil, and so that our cup overflows. So, Father, we pray with David today, and we say with confidence and hope that surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our life, as we long for the days when those who are followers of Jesus may say with confidence and hope that we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. It's in the name of Jesus, our Savior, that we pray today. Amen. As I said, we're going to hear several songs this morning. We're going to listen to one now, and then Wendy Terrazas is going to come and share a few thoughts with us, and then we'll continue on our service. We'll be right back.
my soul will rest in your embrace. I am yours, and you are mine.
Good morning. I just want to thank you for, we're very honored that we're going to get to share some great memories we've had with Jacob. And we're just, Alfonso and I are very blessed that we've been a part of the Page family kids' lives for a long time. And Joel and Anna helped lead our college and career Sunday school class that Jacob was very faithful to. And I just want to read a passage that we read our first Sunday in Sunday school without him. And I want to thank Joel because it was very comforting. And we actually had David on the phone with us for that Sunday school class. And it was just a huge blessing to all of us. It's 1 Corinthians 15:51 is where I'm going to start. It says, "Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Thanks be to God, which give us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." And one thing I'll say about Jacob that I think Jacob would want everyone to know is that you don't have to be perfect to seek Jesus. We're not going to be perfect on this earth. And he sought Jesus with his whole heart. And he loved his Sunday school class. He loved his family. And I just want to share a few things that we talked about in memories that we had. One of the things, and I had just totally, you know, you just forget, you spend so much time and years go by, but one of the things that David reminded me of was that the first time he brought Jacob to youth group, and he brought him up and introduced him to me, and I gave him a big old hug and a big old smile, and Jacob's smile was just, you guys know, his smile was beautiful. And he, there was just a connection there from that point on. And so that's kind of how we started our Sunday school class, was talking about memories and things that we had. And we, one of our memories was Jacob would get coffee. We have a coffee pot in our classroom. And he would get coffee every morning. And Bobby, another one of our Sunday school members, because it's always like Anna, Joel, Jacob, Bobby, and on this futon that we have set on bricks in our classroom. And he Jacob would always get coffee, and then Bobby would always make sure that he showed Jacob his coffee that was full of creamer. Bobby's was always just full of creamer, and Jacob would always say, "That's not good." And Jacob did love his coffee. He loved his Ford Rangers that were always wrecked or broke down, and he loved them and talked about them all the time. He loved Dr. Pepper, especially from Casey's. Troy and we have a lot, we'd have socials at our house, and all of us would get together, and we really enjoyed those times. And one of the things that everybody talked about was how Troy and Joel would always match up against Bobby and Jacob. And they said Troy always won. Joel said that his and Jacob's ability were pretty matched. Troy had some great memories that he shared, and he said he loved to talk. And some people don't know that about him because he seemed pretty quiet, but once you got to know him, he really did like to talk all the time. And he loved to talk, and he was always smiling. And he was a great coworker. And he always tried to make the day better, no matter how long the day was. Jacob loved to work. He loved to weld. And whenever him and Troy were in at Pioneer Tech together, he'd always be like challenging Troy, say, hey, let's see who can lay the best bead down when they were learning how to weld. So he was always, he loved to work, and that really showed in his spirit. And he loved the Lord, and he sought him, and he loved his church, his family. I remember this year he came to me and he said, hey, I think my little niece might be at the elementary school at the school you teach that you're at this year. And I said, really? And he said, yeah. So he loved Liliana, and he just loved being an uncle, and he loved his family so much. And he'd talk about the trips that, you know, sometimes if we were doing something, he already had plans to go on a trip with his family, and he loved that and cherished all of that. I have one more passage from Psalm 34:18 that I want to give to you, family, as comfort to you. The Lord is near you. The Lord is near the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Draw near to him. And then I have one quote that I want to give you because I thought about, this reminds me so much of Jacob. And I hope you can find a little bit of humor and joy in this today. But it's a quote by Dwayne The Rock Johnson. He said, be humble, be hungry, and always be the hardest worker in the room. And that was Jacob. And I love you, and I'm praying for you. Thank you.
Suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. And I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange someday for a crown.
Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. Still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind. Of God. Oh, it chases me down. shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
Knives and shotguns, how to cast an old zip code, how to work a stick shift. He taught me the Bible about all 12 disciples. He made sure that I know there's life after this, with pearly gates and streets of gold. And if I just believe, that's where I'll go. Lord, when I die, I want to live on the outskirts of heaven, where there's dirt roads for miles and hay in the fields and fish in the river. Where there's dogwood trees and honeybees and blue skies and green grass forever. So Lord, when I die, I want to live on the outskirts of heaven. Now it says in the King James, in the Almighty's kingdom, he mentions a mansion that he's built just for me. I'd gladly trade it for a farmhouse with acreage and a backyard that's shady and a squeaky front porch swing. That's where I want to hang my wings when I die. I want to live on the outskirts of heaven, where there's dirt roads for miles and hay in the fields and fish in the river. Where there's dogwood trees and honeybees and blue skies and green grass forever. So Lord, when I die, I want to live on the outskirts. to heaven. The good Lord knows me, He knows I need blue skies and green grass forever. So Lord, when I die, I wanna live on the outskirts of heaven. Lord, when I die, I wanna live on the outskirts of heaven.
Be here before you today. The emotions and the thoughts that are coursing through each one of us right now are probably endless. The pains of grief are deep. The questions are many. The frustration levels are high. Joy feels minimal, and for many, all hope may seem lost. Because of that, I considered many different approaches to what I wanted to say to you this morning. I considered addressing your emotions, your thoughts, your grief, trying to answer questions or ease frustrations, even just trying to encourage you towards joy. I considered addressing how we make the most of every day, of how we value and love those who are around us because of the uncertainties of our life. But what I eventually landed on is what I believe we all probably need some of right now, and that is hope. I want to speak with you for a few moments this morning on the subject of hope in the midst of what seems like a hopeless situation. In the midst of hopelessness, it doesn't really seem possible to grab hold of hope. But in reality, the Bible is full of many pictures of that exact situation. Many of those are found in the Psalms. The one I want to look at today is found in Psalm 42 and 43. The psalmist writes these words. He says, "Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God. For I shall again praise Him, my salvation and my God." In Psalm 42 and 43, there are these cries of brokenness and pain that are punctuated by one resounding theme, and that is to hope in God. You see, when I talk about hope, I'm not talking about some type of generic hope, a hope that says, man, I really wish or hope things would get better. The hope I'm talking about is quite specific. It's a hope in God. And that's quite different than I hope or I wish or I dream of some situation getting better someday. Hope that is generic and not located in God Himself is not really hope. It's simply wishful thinking. The world will always fail you because the world is a broken place, racked by sin and pain. So your hope cannot rest in anything that this world would offer. It can't even rest in people, because no one is perfect. No human being who has ever walked this earth, less one, has ever been perfect, and that means they will eventually fail us as well. So your hope cannot rest in other people. No, your hope must be lodged somewhere that is secure. Something that cannot move and cannot change. Something that will hold you whatever the trials and circumstances of your life bring into your life. Your hope must rest in someone or something that cannot be moved. For your hope to be more than wishful thinking, it must be grounded in someone immovable, someone firm, someone who is not moved when the world is turned upside down. This is why in the midst of the pain and brokenness and even fear, the psalmist turns his heart toward the heavens and reminds himself and reminds us today, hope in God. And he has good reason for needing this hope to be lodged in God, as you and I do today. He was experiencing the world pressing in on him. He wrote in multiple verses, he said at one point, "O God, defend my cause against an ungodly people from deceitful and unjust men. Deliver me. Why do I go about mourning because of the oppression of the enemy?" He was experiencing the world accusing him and testing him and pressing in on him. He says he had had tears has been his food both day and night. Many have asked and questioned him. Maybe he even questioned himself, asking, "Where is your God?" Listen, that's what the world continues to do to us today, is to press in on us, trying to make us feel hopeless. There's an evil one at work even now that wants to eliminate your hope. He wants you to look at situations in your life and say, there's no hope to be found there. The world is pressing in and God has even abandoned me. Psalmist even felt that pain as well. He felt that he was experiencing the absence of God's presence. He said, "You're the God in whom I take refuge. Why have you rejected me?" In Psalm 43. In Psalm 42 he wrote, "I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me?" But I want you to notice something about those statements. Despite what they may appear to be, that God has rejected or forgotten him, notice what he says before he gets to either one of those statements. When he asks the question of why have you rejected me, before he says that, he says, "You're the God in whom I take refuge." Before he says, "Why have you forgotten me?" he said, "I say to God, my rock." In spite of the appearance of being rejected and being forgotten, the psalmist's hope is so focused upon God and the truth of who he is, he knows that even in the apparent absence of God, that God is ever present and always working. You see, true hope deals honestly with pain. It doesn't try to deny it. It doesn't try to act like it doesn't exist. It doesn't try to just make it through. It accepts it, takes it, and yet it continues to turn toward God. You see, even in the midst of pain, God is always working. He's always doing tens of thousands of things that we can never see and may never see, simply because He is God and we are not. God is doing something. He's always working something. And though we cannot see, and we can maintain our hope. And the psalmist knows this. And in the midst of hopelessness, he prays a bold prayer of hope because he knows that God is working something. So he says in Psalm 43, he says, "Send out your light and your truth. In these moments where I feel like you have abandoned me and I cannot find you and I cannot see you, God, would you in those moments send out your light and send out your truth and let them lead me. When I cannot see, let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling." Essentially what he says is, "God, come get me. I can't see you. I can't find you. I don't know where you're at in these moments. Come get me." No matter where you are, no matter what you are thinking, no matter what is happening around you, God can and He will come and get you. God's promised this and He has proven this, not only in the words of the psalmist, but most clearly in the death of His Son. This hope in and hope for the hopeless is what the cross is all about. The psalmist prayed, "Send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill." And the holiness and justice and the goodness of God was on full display on a hill called Calvary. And on that hill, God was doing something for the hopeless. He was doing something for those who could not rescue themselves, those who could not see God. He was coming to get His people. Jacob knew that. He trusted that. He'd given his life to that. That in Christ, God was sending out His light and His truth into the darkness of this world. So Jesus came saying these words, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." You remember what the psalmist prayed? "Send out your light." And Jesus says, "I am the light of the world." The psalmist prayed, "Send out your light and your truth." You know what else Jesus said? He said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." He came to be hope for the hopeless. You can see it at the cross. The darkness of Jesus' death was pierced by a ray of light, in that God's hand was still at work. Not to pull His Son out of the pain, but to carry Him through it. To open up a way for us to come into His presence. For in the darkness of Jesus' death, God Himself tore the veil that separated the people from the presence of God. And in those moments, all the hopeless among us, all those racked by sin and pain, now had a path to walk. A path that led them to hope in God. For you see, we're all stuck in brokenness, trying in so many ways to get out. Though God created this world and He created us perfect, we have marred it by sin and death, and that has come with God's judgment. But because of the cross, because of Jesus taking our guilt upon Himself, our guilt for sinning and breaking fellowship with God, Jesus took upon Himself, and forgiveness is offered for our sin. But the only way to receive that forgiveness and to have a sure and steady hope in God in all the trials of life is to repent of sin and to trust in Christ for forgiveness like Jacob had. And the Scriptures say that if we do that, if we repent of our sin and confess that Jesus is Lord of our lives, then we will be set free to have hope in the hopeless situations, to recover and to pursue God's good design for our life, not to be perfect, but to have hope. To be able to maintain that hope. We will be set free by Christ to have hope no matter the despair. We will be set free in Christ to even bring the hope into the most hopeless of all situations. Jacob's Bible was turned open to Matthew chapter 18, the last text that he had studied with his Sunday school class. In Matthew chapter 18, Jesus is clear. He says, "Any who want to come to me, just come simply like a child." It's not complicated. It's not full of questions. You just come simply, trusting like a child trusts his parents. You come to the Father and you hope in God. Would you listen to this last song? and then we'll pray again together.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind. And grace.
pray with me? Father, we praise you for your grace. A grace that comes to us in our deepest of need. A grace that extends to us in moments where we need hope. We thank you for the confidence that Jesus provides, that this is not the end. That because of Christ, we can have hope in eternity. Father, for those who are in this place who do not have the hope of Christ, we pray that Jacob's testimony and the work of the Spirit would bring them to repentance. They would have the hope of Jesus, to know the hope of eternity. God, we ask you this morning to be with this family, to let your Holy Spirit be their comforter, be their help. Father, that they would know his presence and his peace. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray together. Amen.